Any question? Just interrupt. So I'm Tanya Jabo. I'm working with the LIGO and Robo collaboration, and my talk will be about the quest for the gravitational wave stochastic background. So I don't know how familiar you are with gravitational wave, so again, don't hesitate to interrupt. So what is the gravitational wave stochastic background? The way we define it in any paper is that it's the superposition of many unresolved sources, so sources you cannot detect individually. So unresolved means two different things. The first definition, the one we first thought about, was that there are so many sources that overlap at arrive at the detection at the same time, that even with a perfect detector, perfect sensitivity, you will never be able to separate them and detect them individually. You can think, for example, about family dinner. I don't know how it is in your family, but at Christmas you might not measure that. You, even if you are seated close to someone, you may catch some words, but so many people talk at the same time, you can't really follow any conversation. You just have this huge noise and you can't really identify anything. But we don't have a perfect detector. So the other definition is just that a stochastic background is formed by sources that you cannot resolve individually, either because they are too far away or too faint to be detected. So we also distinguish between two categories of stochastic background, one from cosmological origin, so it was created at a very early time in the universe, so near inflation. And there is another contribution that was created much more recently, since the beginning of stellar activity, and is formed by all the black holes, all the neutron stars, so all the astrophysical sources that can create gravitational waves. Okay, that was for the first definition. So more about now the cosmological background. So the cosmological background is often seen as the early grail of gravitational wave astronomy, because its detection will be a unique, will give unique information on the very early stages of the universe, close to the Planck era, and on the physical law that apply at very high energy scales, energy that cannot be probed at the moment, even at CERN. There is what we call an irreductible background, and it results from the amplification of background fluctuation during inflation. But there can be also active sources that can enhance this cosmological background. I'm going to talk more about this in a few slides, especially at higher frequencies. So in the frequency range of terrestrial detectors, so LIGO. And there are other models that include cosmic phase transitions, first order phase transitions, and also some cosmological defects, for example, of cosmic strings. So they oscillate, they shrink in size, and doing that, they can create a large amount of gravitational waves. So we have very little information, of course, about this stochastic gravitational background. We have not detected it yet, but we have some ideas about the energy density. So the background is usually characterized by this quantity. It's called the energy density parameter, and it's given by so it's the derivative of the energy density in gravitational wave divided by rho c, which is the energy limit to close the universe today. So the amplitude is related to the tensor to scalar ratio, so we have an upper limit which was given by Bicep 2, which is smaller than 0.1, and the omega, the shape also depends on this, not just the amplitude, but also the shape depends on this parameter. And it's, so here in this figure, you have so omega as a function of the frequency, and you can see that unfortunately for us, there is a blue tilt, meaning that this parameter omega is decreasing, not too much, but it's decreasing this frequency. So this parameter is very small in the frequency range of LIGO and VIRGO, and it's really out of reach of the sensitivity of the detector at the moment, and it's also out of reach of LISA, the space detector. So there is no way, even with third generation detector, to see this background at the moment. So this is what we know at the moment about the background. So we have some constraints. So this is a constraint given by CMB observation. This is the irreductible background with a small tilt. It's given, so this is plotted for the upper limit on the tensor to scalar ratio. But we have some models that can predict
there are constructions, the construction yeah. Side, a kilometer or half a kilometer that way.
It's not the gravitational noise.
Unfortunately, no. That would be R of 1,000 or something.
Okay, so, but some inflation scenario can predict enhanced contributions. So, there are some hope we could have more gravitational wave at in our frequency range. So there are a few examples here. So one is given in the context of action inflation coupling, and also stiff equation of states can predict more gravitational waves at high frequencies. So there are some hope we may detect some cosmological background with advanced LIGO and VIRGO, but also with third generation detectors, Einstein telescope or Cosmic Explorer. And we have no idea where the background is, but no detection, if we have no detection, we'll be able to put some constraints of some models, and if we have the detection, it will be, of course, a lot of work for people working on the theory. So, there is another background that is also important. This is the astrophysical background. So not formed in the very early stages of the universe. There is no constraints on this background by CMB observation because it was formed after. And it's created by all the sources, the astrophysical sources, in the beginning of stellar activity. So this background is, usually I work on cosmological background, on astrophysical backgrounds, and sometimes people ask me, okay, but if you have individual detections, why do you care about detecting the background? You will have less information with the background. So the answer is no, because we are not looking at the same population. With individual detection, we have access to sources at low redshift. And with a stochastic background, we probe all the signal coming from sources at high redshift. So for example, if we detect the astrophysical background, we can learn about the star formation history, the evolution of the metallicity with redshift, and also the evolution of the parameter of sources with redshift and metallicity. So, for example, we detected the collision of black holes with LIGO. We have three now. And they are from redshift less than 0.1. And we know masses of the black holes can be larger if we are low metallicity. So with the baryon, we'll be able to follow the evolution of the masses with metallicity, for example. That's just an example of things we'll be able to do. So there are many, many information we can extract from a detection of an astrophysical background. And these information will be complementary with the information we can have with individual detections. So this background, the bad news is that, we can learn a lot with this background. The bad news is that it will mask the cosmological background, because we expect the amplitude of the astrophysical background to be larger. And but there are some hope we can maybe subtract it. I will talk about this later. And also the statistical properties of the astrophysical background may be different. So there may be some ways to separate the two backgrounds. So we need new detection strategies and analysis techniques. So just to illustrate, so this is a plot showing again omega as a function of the frequencies, but for some astrophysical contribution. And what you can see is that in the frequency band of LIGO, so between, so one is for third generation detectors, a cosmic explorer of Einstein telescope will be able to go down to about 1 Hertz, but LIGO start at 10 Hertz. And stochastic, the most of the sensitivity for stochastic baryon is between 10 and 100 Hertz. And in this frequency band, you can see that the main contribution is given by all the collision of binary sources. So binary neutron stars, or binary black holes, or neutron star and black hole. So this contribution is really expected to dominate, and over all the other astrophysical background, but also over the cosmological background. So now, how do we detect the stochastic background? The stochastic background is exactly like a noise in the for one detector. So the only way is to use two at least, or a network of detectors, and do a cross-correlation product of the output. So doing this, if we do so, this is a signal we receive at the detector. So there is the contribution from gravitational waves, H, and also the noise. And if we do the cross-correlation product of the output of two detectors, so we get rid of the noise because the noise in the two detectors are not correlated. Of course, the signal and the noise are not correlated. So just remain the cross product of the gravitational wave signal. So that's the ideal case, because I said that the noise is not correlated, but it's not completely true. But even though, since the detectors are separated, they're not located at the same place, we can decrease a lot the level of the noise. So that was the idea. No, this is what we really do. We work in the frequency domain. And we do the cross-correlation product this way. We use what we call an optimal filter, which is given by this expression. So the optimal filter is constructed, so it depends on the noise in the two detectors, P1 and P2. It depends on the shape of the signal. We need to have some ideas of the signal we want to detect. So usually we assume a simple shape, which is just a power law. And if you look at this, it's fine, because usually in our frequency range, all the models predict a color. And for double neutron stars or double black holes, we know exactly what it is. It's F to the power of 2/3. And most of the cosmological background, we can assume just a flat background. And so the result is that the average value of this quantity gives us an estimate of the signal. And if we take the variance, it gives an estimate of the noise. And what's important to know is that the performance, the signal-to-noise ratio, evolves as the square root of the observation time. So for individual sources, we can't do that. You receive a source, it will last for a few seconds. But the stochastic background is always here. So we can integrate for a very long period of time. It's not a very high amplitude, but we have time to integrate. And doing this, we are going to decrease the level of the noise and improve the level of the signal. And the result is that the ratio between the signal and the noise will evolve at the square root of the observation time. So this is the network of gravitational detectors we have at the moment. So we have two detectors in the US, one in Hanford in the state of Washington, and the other in Louisiana. So these two detectors made the first detections in 2015. There is also a European project between France and Italy, but now there are also contributions from the Netherlands and Hungary, Poland. So Virgo is hopefully going to take data this summer, so joining the two of us. And it's very important, especially for the localization of the sources. There are also a detector in the in Hanover, but not the same sensitivity, smaller size. But there is a project in Japan, Kagura. And another LIGO will be built in India, which will be also very, very good for the localization because it's more in the source. So this is what we have at the moment. At the moment we have two detectors and soon three. So in this expression for the optimal filter, an important ingredient is what we call the overlap reduction function. The overlap reduction function is just, it characterizes the loss of sensitivity due to the separation of the detectors, but also their relative orientation. So if the detectors are at the same location and oriented the same way, so they are L-shaped detectors, the overlap reduction function will be 1. All the time. But it's not what we have. So for the two LIGO, the orientation is quite good. So at low frequency, it will start close to, so -1 or +1 is not important because what's important is the absolute value. So it's close to 1. But as you can see, it will oscillate and the amplitude will decrease when we increase the frequency. That's because of the separation. Like Virgo, which is in Europe, and LIGO are not very well oriented. The orientation is not as good, so it starts at 0.2, something like that. And it will decrease faster because of the separation between Europe and the US is bigger. Another example is the pair between Geo and Virgo. They are both in Europe, but for some reason the orientation is just the worst you can imagine. So there is no hope we can do anything with these two detectors for stochastic power. And of course, because they are very close, the oscillations with this overlap reduction function is almost constant for a very long time. Alright, so this is really something that will reduce a lot is to a stochastic problem. Alright, so next, what did we learn from the first LIGO detections? So you probably have heard of that. On September 14, 2015, the two LIGO detectors registered the first gravitational wave signal, and it was from the collision of two black holes in a distant galaxy 1.3 billion years ago. And these black holes were quite, the masses were quite high, that was a big surprise, almost 30 solar masses. And we were very surprised because the masses we detect in the, we measure from low mass X-ray binaries in our galaxy are all less than 20 solar mass, and this one was 30. Okay, so beside the, so at the moment we have three detections plus one. So we had this one made in 2015. A month after, we recorded another event. It was at the limit of the detection threshold, so we can't claim it's a detection, but most people think that it's probably the collision of two black holes too. In December, we had, so this one is confirmed, the collision of two black holes again. It was made in, called the Boxing Day event. It was just the day after Christmas. And now in the second, that was for the first observation run. And in the second observation run, we've just published a paper with the observation of a third black hole. Three, maybe four at the moment. But besides all these close events we have detected, there is this, all these sources that are too faint at higher redshift that produce gravitational wave stochastic background. And what we learned from this first LIGO detection was that the masses could be larger than what we expected before. And since we detected black holes so early, probably the rate is larger too. So something important to understand is that it was really crazy because we just turned off the interferometer and we received this first event, this big tweet from the universe just at the time we turned off the computer, the interferometer. So after that, we revised our prediction of the gravitational wave stochastic background. So this is the recipe to do the calculation. So I told you about the energy density of gravitational waves. And the way we calculate this parameter is that we integrate over all redshift, over all the masses, all the spins also of the black holes. So we just add together all the individual sources. And it's given by this integral. So this is the rate in the redshift between z and z plus dz, so in a redshift interval. And this is the individual spectral energy of one source at this frequency, at this redshift, and for given parameters. And we integrate over all the possible parameters and over all the redshifts. So, I'm sorry, this is wrong. It's already here. Just forget about this last. So, when we had just one detection, we revised our predictions. And what do we know with the individual detection? We know the masses of the two black holes. We can also estimate the local rate, so how many sources we have in some volume and prayer. So that's the information we have. To do the calculation, we also need to make some assumptions. So we assume, for example, that massive black holes, like the one we detected, can be created only at for small metallicities. We need a model for the star formation history, and we have also So this is the I don't know if I have to go into these details. So the rate of collision of black holes is given by the star formation. It follows the star formation rate, but we have also to take into account the delay between the formation of the stars that will give black holes and the quiescence. So we have two times: the time it takes to for the stars to evolve into black holes, and after the time for the two black holes to merge due to the emission of gravitational waves. So which is what it's written here. So we make some assumptions for this the probability distribution of this delay. And from population synthesis, we assume that this delay is quite small. And this is what we obtained. So in blue, you have the omega, or the population of binary black holes. It has a very characteristic shape. As I told you, it evolves as a power law, which is f to the 2/3. And the pink region is just the uncertainty we have on the rate, because we detected just one event. So of course, the rate, the estimation of the rate is very uncertain. And this corresponds to the error we have on the rate. And these curves here are just the evolution of the sensitivity, because LIGO is going to, the sensitivity is going to improve until 2022, and this, so here it's the sensitivity we had in 2016, and there will be different phases with improvement of the sensitivity, and that will be the final sensitivity. So you can see that this background, there is good chances that it could be detected in the next few years. Okay, it should be the other way. That's just the time series. You can see that the amplitude from gravitational waves as a function of time. And you can see that the background from binary black holes is not a continuous background. There are gaps with no gravitational wave signal. This is what we call a popcorn noise. So if we have a perfect detector, it will not be a stochastic background, but we can separate the sources. They don't overlap. But since we don't have a perfect detector, many of these sources can be detected individually and they create a stochastic background. Okay, so we made some, to calculate this background, we made a few assumptions. So the question we ask is, if we change the models we are using, are we going to change significantly the predictions? And the answer is no. So we tested many other models. We changed the star formation rate. We changed the probability distribution of the delay. We assume longer delay between the formation of the star and the coalescence, and all these changes are less than are within the uncertainty we have on the rate. So after the end of the first observational run, we had three detections, but just one. So we did the calculation again in within the two other events. And I was very surprised by this, but the prediction didn't change really. Omega, the average value was exactly the same, but the difference is that the uncertainty decreased. So the error was smaller because we had more events, but the omega was average omega was the same, meaning that our first predictions were quite robust. The difference here between blue and pink is just the difference between using two different mass distributions. So there is no difference in the frequency range we are interested in. So this was just the evolution of the signal to noise ratio with the observation time, if you can look at this. So the jumps correspond to the change in sensitivity. So the blue again correspond to the average value. The pink region correspond to the error on the rate. And so the question now is not, will we be able to detect this gravitational background? The question is, when will we be able to detect it? So I'm going to finish with this, I think. So we analyze the data to search for a stochastic background for the first observational run. And of course, we didn't see anything yet. The sensitivity is not very good, and the time was not long enough. But compared to the initial LIGO and Virgo, we have already an improvement of the factor of 33. In the upper limit of omega. Okay, so just to finish, I wanted to say that what we want to do now is to detect this astrophysical background. But when we have the detection, the next step will be to suppress it to detect the cosmological background. And we are currently investigating this. With third generation detectors, we should be able to observe each individual binary black hole if we have a network of five detectors. So there are some hope we'll be able to see the cosmological background. So that's in theory. We have to develop data analysis techniques to really do correctly the subtraction. So it's a very exciting time for gravitational wave astronomy. We had the first detection, and also these are the first the space detector finished ESA Pathfinder, a test mission that was a big success. The sensitivity was better than predicted and expected. In addition to individuals, so these close individual sources we are detecting at the moment. There is this stochastic background of binary black holes that will probe the high redshift population, and we want to detect it. And again, I insist, the ultimate goal will be to subtract this background and observe the cosmological background, which will be a unique way to probe these very, very early stages of the universe and inflation scenarios.
For Tanya?
So with regard to bullet three, with regard to this last one, so you're at 10 to the minus 8 or 10 to the minus 9 for the background from the black holes.
For LIGO, yes, but third generation detectors with 10 to the minus 13.
So how low, I mean, if you subtract the astrophysical foreground, how low do you think you can go?
2 10 to the minus 13.
With LIGO?
No, with Einstein telescope. And so this is for third generation detectors.
Can you show the slide where you had the cosmological signals?
Okay, so that's for more advanced LIGO. So that's the background from double black holes.
Right, right.
So you can, if you subtract the sources, you can individually detect. You get here, for, that's blue and red correspond to two different mass distributions, two models. And you have, if you have three detectors or five detectors, so you see that you can just get there, but this is still really too high. But with third generation detectors, you can almost subtract everything. And this is the limit you have for, at the moment, for the background from inflation, but as I told you, you can have higher contributions due to other inflation scenarios. And so here, 2×10⁻¹³ is the sensitivity of the detectors. So you can subtract all the sources and get this level.
And this is assuming, let's see, ET is Einstein telescope?
Einstein telescope and cosmic explorer sensitivity.
Oh, cosmic.
So the sensitivities are here. Again, a factor of 10 in sensitivity.
So cosmic explorer is beyond LISA.
ET is a European project, and cosmic explorer is the American project.
Okay.
So there are two sensitivities. There are predictions, but they will be almost the same. We don't know what it will be exactly. When I talk to instrumentalists, usually they're asking them, okay, what sensitivity should I assume for my calculation? And say, okay, we produce these sensitivities for you, for people working on theory, but honestly, we do what we can. And, do our best and see what we get.
What would the Cosmic Explorer look like?
Cosmic Explorer?
Yeah, come on.
I can tell you more about Einstein Telescope. It will be, so in Europe, it will be a triangle. So there will be three independent, really independent detectors because we have six independent lasers. What else? It will be underground. So we can get rid of the seismic noise. So instead of 10 Hertz, the low frequency band will be, that's another question, between 1 and 5, we have to decide. If we choose 1, the sensitivity will be a bit worse. And Cosmic Explorer is, they are both cryogenic, also.
The main difference is that Cosmic Explorer is basically LIGO, but much bigger than cryogenic.
Instead of 4 kilometers, it will be 10 kilometers.
Okay.
Yeah. So ET will be 10 kilometers in arm length, and Cosmic Explorer is 40 kilometers in arm length.
Okay.
So they are both futuristic.
Right.
Yes. So what would be the time scale?
So 2030, at the time of LISA. And another thing that could be nice to do, I can talk about that, all these black holes we expect to detect with these third generation detectors, they will be present in the LISA band too, but 5 years before. And something funny I think we can try to do is to detect them in Einstein Telescope and Cosmic Explorer, and then go back to 5 years before and try to subtract them also in LISA and try to recover the cosmological background. Because there will be a background from the first order phase transition in LISA we don't have in LIGO.
Okay. One more question.
This is a more theoretical question. Are there any good ideas as to how to produce gravitational wave signal and their intensities from early reverse phase transitions, for example, associated to well-motivated stuff like radiation. I mean, it would be nice to have a reference, at least for people like me, to learn about these things.
Well, a paper from the LISA collaboration summarizing all these cosmological parallels. So, for instance, I'm not an expert on these cosmological parallels. How you produce the idea, I think, is that you have the birth of the new phase that grow and accelerate and start to collide. And this will produce a large amount of gravitational waves. It's like when you go from the
water.
See, you need first start the phase transition.
Yes. But it would be very interesting because this could be related perhaps to electroweak paragenesis or other phenomena.
Yeah, well, some part of the UCD phase transition, although I don't remember if that's a derived frequency. I'm no expert either, but remember that UCD phase transition is one possibility. But I don't remember the frequency.
So for LISA, there is really hope that you can see is LIGO, there is no detected transition at this frequency.
Do you want to read the scale phase transition of LISA? Excuse me, phase transition is not the first order in the
results.
Okay. It's only TV scale, but three for about two set phase transition, maybe an extended model.
Yeah.
A triple for a single.
That's
okay, so let's thank Tanya again.